Well, I have some bad news. You got me for about another 5 minutes, but so therefore, turn to your Bibles. Hebrews chapter 10. That's where we're going this morning. I have got to tell you, that it is an immense joy for me to be able to lead us in worship almost every weekend. And one of the great joys that I have being on staff in the worship ministry is I also get to plan services as well. Now, God chose for me to set foot into this world in a little town in South London in 1977. But if he had ordained the same task in my life in Old Testament Jerusalem, then at this point in the service, I would say, bring out the goat and let us sacrifice the goat as a sin offering. Thank you, Lord, that we don't have to do that. Because of Jesus. And let me give you a little context to the book of Hebrews. Hebrews was written to the nation of Israel when they had been practicing these sacrificial offerings for thousands of years. And that used to be the way that it was done, but Jesus. We pick it up in verse 3. It says, in these sacrifices there is a reminder of sin every year. For it is impossible, though, for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Consequently, when Christ came into the world, he said, sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body you have prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure. Then I said, behold, I have come to do your will, O God, as it is written of me in the scroll of the book. And by that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. When Jesus gave his life for all, he eliminated the sacrificial system. Eliminated it. God sent his perfect Son to be sacrificed once and for all. Your sin, my sin, your past sin, your present sin, your future sin, all of it, once and for all. And for those of us here who have turned from our sin and embraced Jesus Christ by faith, we have experienced the goodness of God that we have been singing about this morning. As we engage in worship, I can see it, I can sense it. I know that goodness of God in my life as you sing out those words. For those of you who haven't turned from your sin and embraced Jesus as your Savior, you can do that this morning. You can do that right now. Right after the service, if you want to, any of our pastors would love to talk with you, to pray with you, and to give you that opportunity for you to make the choice, the personal choice, to have eternal life with the Lord because of Jesus. Because of Jesus. And for those of us who call ourselves Christ followers, that is a free gift. But in this passage, we will see that Jesus is asking us to do a few things in return. So we're going to verse 19 to 22 first, and I'm going to bring point one of our message this morning. The message is called, This Is Us, Five Commitments for God's People, and I'm going to point one, which is draw near. Verses 19 to 22 says, therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through the flesh, And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. When Jesus made this sacrifice for us, he gave us access to God. He gave us closeness to God. Beforehand, like I was saying, this would be done by a priest who once a year, just once a year, would be allowed access to the Holy of Holies. He would wash himself. He would put on clothes that God had asked him to put on. He would go into the holy place. He would go through the curtain. These are important words. And he would take the blood from that sacrificed goat and he would sprinkle it over the Ark of the Covenant. That was called the Day of Atonement. And that would temporarily satisfy God's wrath, God's anger towards our sin. But Jesus did it once for all. Let me read that verse 21 again. Since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us, here it is, through the curtain, that is through his flesh. And since we have a great high priest now over the house of God, it tells us, let us draw near. We now have access to the Holy of Holies in this place, in your relationship with the Lord. You have access to the Holy of Holies. You now no longer need a representative to go between you and the Lord. Amen? Amen? God wants you to go directly into his presence and to draw near to him. Can I tell you a story about my wedding? My wife and I, Joanna, we got married in South Carolina on the beach. It's a long story how we picked that, but I invited a few people from the staff who, approaching the big day, I consequently found out were flying to my wedding before I was. And I actually led worship. They left after the 9 a.m. service. Some of them served in the 9 a.m. service and then left. And I led worship at the 11 o'clock service while everybody else flew to my wedding. That was an interesting day for me. The wedding actually wasn't until the next day, but that day was filled with anxiety for me. I led worship at that 11 a.m. service. It felt like it went on for 4 hours. Then I went home and I grabbed my stuff, and then I went down to the airport, and then I had to wait for the plane and hope the plane wasn't delayed, and then I got on the plane, and the plane ride seemed to take another, like, 20 hours, and then I got to Charleston, and I got a rental car, and I drove too fast, and I got a ticket on the way to the house, and when I arrived at the house, I, like, didn't even get my bags out. I just wanted to get into the house, and my future brother-in-law tried to play this practical joke on me as I got to the top of the steps, and I was like, I don't even care, get out of my way, because I wanted to see the girl. Because when I saw her, then the reality of that wedding ceremony was real for me. Now it was going to happen. Now I was here. In the same way, God is preparing a wedding feast for you. And he wants you to draw near. How? How can we draw near to that day? Our time is ticking. God has chosen for us a time that we will see him face to face. But in the meantime, I want to give you three things that are so crucial for us to draw near to him. Number one, talk to him. You cannot have a relationship with someone that you don't talk to. Fact. Sometimes people ask me, do you know this person? And I'm like, yeah, kinda. And maybe. And then sometimes they'll ask me, do you know this person? And I'm like, oh yeah, I totally know that person. Just based upon how much communication I've had with them, usually. Because I'm talking with them and I'm getting to know them. Jesus even gives us a secret to talking with God. Matthew 6, read that in your own time. The secret to talking with God is talking to God in secret. Find a secret place. Go there. Close your door. Pray to your Father who's in secret, because your Father who's in secret will reward you. Jesus says, this is where he is, and this is what will happen. That reward, answered prayer, I hope. But I believe even more than that, it's nearness and closeness to God. Talk to him. Find your secret place this week. For me, it's my car. I have four boys at home. There's not a single place in my house that's a secret place. But when I get in my car and I turn my stereo off and have the discipline to do so and I start talking to God, he becomes present. Because God always becomes present when we turn our affections to him. Talk to him. Number two, praise him. Praise him. He's worthy of that praise. When we do that in this room, something very interesting happens. I have a church. It's a little church. It's right down the road. There's six of us in our congregation, and I am the father, and I have four sons, and for the last 13 years, when I arrive at the house, usually the littlest at that point will open the door and come running towards me and do something very interesting with his hands. He raises them, not to praise me, but because he's near to his Father. And we do the same thing when we praise him. The evidence of his proximity and how important this gathering is to praise him. Find opportunities as much as you can to praise him. And lastly, listen to him. He is speaking to you. He has something for you. Where? In his word, obviously. Open it. Read it. It's alive. I cannot tell you as a worship leader how many times I've spoken the word of God out from a stage and realized these are the same words, but this is a different thing that's happening in the room from the last time I said this, because I'm handling something that's alive. And God wants to speak to you through his word because it's alive. He also wants to speak to you through people who are in God's word. That's why we're encouraging you to get into small groups, because we want you to be in community, in a smaller community than 1,000 people in a room, where you're surrounded by people who are in God's word, because as you're in God's word and community with them, someone's going to put a hand on your shoulder every once in a while and say, I want to encourage you by saying this. And that might be the Lord speaking to you. And in the same way, he also wants to speak to your heart through the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is alive and has a voice in your life. And sometimes that's called discernment. And being able to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit and then go back to the Word of God and saying, Lord, does this measure up to what I've heard from this person or what I've heard in my heart is critical. If we are learning the voice of the Lord and the Holy Spirit through the Word of God. Talk to him, praise him, listen to him as we draw near.
And we draw near by faith. We stay near through hope. If you're taking notes, jot down this second characteristic. We hold fast. We hold fast. Hebrews 10, verse 23 says, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who promised is faithful. The writer of Hebrews is offering to you and to me a magnet that's going to draw us back time and time again when life gets hard and it gets difficult. He's giving us something that can draw us back in that moment to where we need to be. Let's break down that verse real quick. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope. The confession of our hope is what this whole chapter is about. Jesus Christ, permanent sacrifice for sin. The once and for all perfect Lamb of God who went to a Roman cross for you and for me, not so that we have to be better than the next guy, not so we have to earn our favor before God, but instead that it's paid for in full. This is our hope. Because if it's up to me to get to heaven, I could live a billion times and never come close to perfection. But if perfection is offered to me freely, I can embrace it. That gives me great hope. Without wavering, not veering off course, not second guessing, but standing strong in the promises and person of God because the payment was permanent. We don't have to waver or second guess because if it's a promise God has made to us, it's a promise he's going to fulfill. And that's why it says next that for he who promised is faithful. God promised the people of Israel a Messiah. He promised the world a king. And he answered those promises in the person of Jesus. He was faithful to them. God is incapable of lying. And so when he makes a promise to us, it means we can cling to it and hope in it because we know it's going to come to pass. It's going to happen. We can be confident in looking ahead. The Greek word for holding fast is this, kapeo. It means to hold on or to keep a firm grip. That's what it means. And the other day I was watching Netflix. I do that a lot. I'm, 26. That's what we do. And I'm watching Netflix, this documentary called Free Solo. It's about this guy named Alex Honnold. This is Alex Honnold. First thing you need to know about Alex Honnold, he's a lunatic. What do you mean, Pastor Brandon? Well, here's what I mean. This guy, he looks at mountain faces and he thinks, I want to climb that. Some of us would think that's crazy. But he goes to another level that's just unbelievable. He sees El Capitan, the mountain you see right there. It's Yosemite in Yosemite National Park out west, and it's 3,000 feet tall. He sees that and he thinks, not only do I want to climb that mountain, I want to do it without ropes. What? Yeah, that's this guy, Alex Honnold, okay? So what he does is he goes to these mountain faces. He starts climbing them with ropes. That's where he starts. And he trains and he trains and he trains. And he figures out every grip, every crevice, every single foothold. And he wants to make sure that he knows his route up the mountain, how to summit the peak, right? And then one day he's like, sure, this is the day. I'm not going to do it without ropes. And he just starts climbing. And he does this route. And he's putting his hands in the places, his foot where they need to go. And every single moment, every move that he makes is significant. Every grip that he grabs onto is intentional. Because he's clinging to this mountainside like his life depends on it. We hold on to the person of Jesus. We hold on to the promises of Jesus Christ like our life depends on it because it does. We hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering because our hope isn't slippery. Our hope isn't unstable. Our hope is sure. It's unshakable. It's Jesus. So, if you're like me, you're like, okay, so that's all like the mental stuff. How can I play this out on the ground, Pastor Brandon? Well, here's how to hold fast. First thing, check your desires. Check your desires. Like, where is your ultimate hope at? What is it placed in? Because your hope is only as strong as the object it's placed on. If I had a hope that this table would support me, I'd probably climb up on this and fall down the stairs right now because it's not very stable right now. Our hope is strong and it's secure. Ask yourself this question when you're thinking through your hope and discerning. what in my life, when it goes wrong, am I the most dissatisfied or the most stressed out about? Like if I didn't get that promotion or I didn't get that house or my kid didn't get into that college, would I be crushed? Would my life be a mess because of that? You gotta check your desires. Maybe you're looking for a better situation. Maybe you're looking and placing your hope into a better and purer world. Maybe it's in like politics. Maybe it's in an improved person. Like if your marriage is just in this place, then all of a sudden your life would be so much satisfactory. Until your ultimate hope is placed in Jesus, none of those things will be able to satisfy you. Having a good marriage is good. Having sons and daughters who grow up to love Jesus and are successful, that's a good thing. But if that's where your ultimate hope lies, it's not going to fulfill you. So here's the second thing. You got to filter those desires through the cross and eternity. Filter those desires through the cross and eternity. Ask yourself whether or not, one, Jesus has paid for this already. Like, is this something Jesus has offered to you through the cross? Or thirdly, ask yourself this, like, hey, will this matter in 5 years? Will it matter in 10 years? Will it matter in 50 years, 100 years? Christians live with eternity in focus and in our hopes because that, at the end of the day, is where we're going to be. That's where everybody's going to spend, an eternity, either with God and his people or apart from him. Filter them through the cross and eternity. Third thing on this list is write God's promises on your heart. Write God's promises on your heart. Nothing will instill more hope in your spirit than having God's great and precious promises stored in your heart. Psalm 119, 49, 50 says, remember your word to your servant in which you have made me hope. This is my comfort in my affliction, that your promise gives me life. Have God's promises deeply stored within you so that the moment the life tells you that they don't mean something, you have them and say, no, this is what the truth is. I have it. I know it. It's mine. And fifthly, repeat, repeat, repeat. Now, every single perfectionist in the room was like, number four, you missed number four. Pastor Brandon, what are you doing? You lost your notes. I know it's your first time. No. We're going to get there. You see, you have to repeat these things, but you can't do these things alone. It's impossible to do everything God's word is asking you to do alone. Number four is we need to do this together.
Let's look down at our Bibles at verse 24, and let's read it together. It says, and let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works. It says, and let us. If you guys have been noticing a pattern that's been happening, thank you, Pastor Britt, same shirt. If you've been noticing the pattern that's happening in the scripture, the phrase let us has been happening. Do you see it? It says, let us draw near. Let us hold fast. And now it says, let us consider. Let us consider. That's what we're doing right now. Let us. This is us. These are the commitments, the characteristics of God's people, of the church. Let us consider. Consider, the Greek word here means to observe carefully, to be diligent, to look intently at, or to focus on. This isn't something that is to be thought of briefly in my head for just a couple of seconds. It's not just a fleeting thing that's going in one ear and out the other. This isn't a, good thought. This is intentional. Let us consider. Let us consider. It's intentional. And we see this word used one more time in the book of Hebrews. And it's actually used earlier in Hebrews chapter 3, verse 1. I'll read it for us. It says, therefore, holy brothers, you who share in a heavenly calling, consider Jesus, the apostle and high priest of our confession. The disciples are to consider Jesus. Consider Jesus. To focus on him. To be intentional with him. So what are we to consider? What are we supposed to do with this? It says, let's read together, "And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works." That's the next characteristic that we see. It's the third one. We stir up. This is us. We stir up. And this isn't teaching us on how to just love one another. This is teaching to stir up one another to love and good works. Stir up in this passage, in this scripture, is the verb. It requires action, to stir up. And stir up simply means to agitate, to bring passion to. Some translations, maybe you have this, it says to stimulate one another to love and good works. Agitate one another to love and good works. This is what we do as God's people, as a Christian community. This is what we do. This is us. We need to be agitating one another. We need to be bringing passion to one another, stimulating one another to love and good works. I brought something. I feel like I always bring stuff, but I figured this kind of describes perfectly. This is called a Nutribullet, and I don't have a lot of experience with this because my wife does all the smoothie making in our house. I'm bad at it. She's just good, you know. I don't know. And it's a blender. And apparently it does really only one thing. It doesn't have any like different kind of modes or anything like that. You just push on it and it blends. It stirs up. And I thought that this was a perfect visual of what we are to do with one another. We are the blade. We are the people who stir up one another. And we're stirring up one another. This could be one another. And we're stirring them up to incredible things, love and good works. And I think that there is a perfect definition of love in the book of 1 Corinthians 13. Maybe you had this read at your wedding or you've heard this many, many times. I have it in my Bible, and in the margin of my Bible it says, "Remember to love Kelly like this." And we need to really remember to love all people like this, everyone like this. This is how we're to love. Says this, "Love is patient and love is kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things." That's love. And that's what we're to stir up in one another. Love, patience, and kindness, and blueberry juice. There they are. I'm just going to get a lot of that in there. A lot of love. Some more love, you know. Now you might be wondering, you know, "Pastor Tommy, why are you doing this?" And one, because I think that it perfectly illustrates this, but also I did not have breakfast this morning. So here we go. But not only love and the things that love brings, but also good works. We're to stir up good works in one another. And I brought coconut milk, which is supposed to be good for you. I'm just going to put that in there. Just tell me when to stop. Should I just keep going? Don't stop. Okay. And we're to stir these up in one another. We're to be the blade that agitates and stimulates and brings passion to each other. Look at that. It's agitating, it's stimulating, it's stirring up. It's taking things and making them into this beautiful, hopefully delicious drink. We're to stir one another up to love and good works. The aim of this type of life on life ministry, this mutual ministry that we have in the church with one another in our Christian community, is sustaining and strengthening our faith in Jesus Christ. And through that faith in Jesus Christ, the aim is to love people and do good works, to stir up those in one another. This is us. So how do we do that? How do we stir up love and good works in each other? Well, the first thing is to be the example. be the model, to have these things be true in your life, to be full of love for people, to be doing good works. And simply, good works are obeying Jesus Christ and serving him. That's what good works are. And so we're loving people and obeying Jesus and we're serving him. We're doing that. I'm going first. I'm being the example. We're doing that so that it will stir up. And sometimes that's the only step that's needed, because someone will look at your life and they'll say, wow, there's something different about them. They really love people in a different way. They really, like, they're constantly, like, serving at their church and serving underprivileged people, and, like, they're different. There's something different, and that might stir up in them, agitate in them, bring passion to them to step forward and to start doing those things themselves. I know that we've said this, but I think Kyle Rochin is a perfect example of being the model of this, and he's done that not only for me in worship in my life, but he's done it for so many students that he's taught over the years, and he is an example of stirring up one another to love and good works. The next thing is not only to be the example, but communicate the information. It's to teach. It's to teach others. It's not just to be it. It's to go and teach it too. Listen, I'm going to do all of these things in my life, and then I'm going to tell you exactly what you need to do. What do you need to do to stir up love and good works in others? It's not just doing it, it's teaching it, it's bringing it to other people. Be the example, communicate the information, and then finally this, walk with them. Walk with them. Don't just be it and teach it and leave. Come alongside. This is our Christian community. This is discipleship. Coming alongside one another, walking with them through it. That's how we can stir one another up to love and good works. And then here's the fourth thing. Repeat it. Repeat it. This isn't something that just happens once. It happens as soon as you walk someone through that and they start catching it and bringing it out. You start right back over. Repeat, repeat, repeat. So I'm going to do my best to stir you up right now. And I want to give you something today that is going to help in these exact areas of love and good works, to stir you up in them. And if you walk through our West Lobby, you know exactly what I'm going to talk about already. First thing is to stir up love. Love. If you look at 1 Corinthians 13 and all of those things, patience and kindness, love is not something that you can do on your own. You can't do it alone. You need other people to be a part of it, to love. Love is patient. You need someone to be patient with. Love is kind. You need someone to be kind to. It's not to be done by yourself. It's to be done with others. That's what love is. It's to be done with other people. And really, we have a perfect vehicle for you to do exactly that, and it's called small groups. And in the lobby, we have boards of couples and men's and women's and young adults and students, small groups that you could go and you could get into a Christian community right now. Today, you could leave today with a group of Christian believers who are going to stir love into one another. You could join a small group. But also this, good works. We also, out in our lobby after the service, we don't just have small groups, we have serving opportunities, and we have three of them: Harvest Kids, Harvest Students, and Weekend Services. What a great opportunity for you to jump in and do good work serving Jesus and the church in those areas. And through even a couple of those, you can also stir one another up to love and good works through serving in those areas. We all tend to drift into selfishness, don't we? That's our tendency, is to worry about myself, think about myself. I'm drifting always ever more into selfishness. But the truth is, according to God's word, God has appointed you to help a few others in your Christian community to persevere in love and good works.
Okay, then We can look at verse 25, following up from what Tommy had to say. Verse 25 says this, not neglecting to meet together as it is the habit of some. So in Harvest Kids, we would illustrate or we would describe that verse as, here's how it goes. Are you ready? Go to church. Or for adults, it would be, and a small group. You can't do it on your own, gang. It's impossible to do the things that Pastor Brandon and Pastor Tommy talked about. It's impossible to hold on. It's impossible to stir up. This is us. And if it's not us, it's me. It doesn't say that. It says it's us. So we got to go to church. We've got to be in fellowship with one another. That's where it all happens. It's not just me, it's us. And so the fourth thing this week is we gather. Now the church in Hebrews here, they've been meeting in homes and they've been meeting in the synagogues. And boy, doesn't that sound like what we're talking about? Small groups, homes, synagogues, church. And there's a little discouragement going on here. For a long time that they've been persecuted pretty hard, and some of them are probably wondering, is it worth it? And this following Jesus thing, is it really worth the trouble I'm in? And so the natural thing when we're in that kind of a mindset is, what does the second part of that verse say? It says, as it is the habit of some. You can't pull away. But when we're discouraged or disillusioned or disappointed, that seems to be our natural tendency, doesn't it? And then we all have come across or heard or maybe used for ourselves is some of these great classic examples of excuses. Well, I'm busy with, and fill in the blank, with whatever you're busy with. Well, my kids have, and fill in whatever that is. Or I've been let down by someone there. Or here's a great one. I don't really need church. I have Jesus. Okay, but we can't do it ourselves. We've heard that already this morning. And then the problem is, or the thing that happens is that the excuses become real easy then. You know, the first excuse is the most difficult, and then it gets easier and easier and easier as we pull away, as we disappear, as we stop going to church. We need each other, is what it says here. It says, don't neglect them to meet together. God didn't design us to be the Lone Ranger Christian. It's not how it works. And how often have we heard the stories of people that have been going to church for a long time, and then all of a sudden, for whatever reason, doesn't really matter, they stop going to church, and despair, and life goes down the tubes, and they end up in places where none of us really want to be. And then you hear the stories of how they jump back in, and they begin to be blessed by others, and then bless others, and pull alongside and are pulled alongside of and shoulder kingdom responsibilities, and then pretty soon they're a God at work video. They isolated themselves and it went south pretty quick. And they did church together and it was, this is us, and life begins to, with the encouragement and the help that the church brings to them. Or maybe it's the, you know, you hear the stories of someone who has gotten saved at a rally and never gets plugged into a church. Or they get saved in Awana or junior high or senior high ministry, and then they go off to college, and in a couple of months or a year's time, they're back wallowing in their sin and life is bad, and it's because they haven't been plugged in, because they're on their own, because they've isolated. Now, I'm not talking about, gang, you did not hear me say that, well, let's put it this way. We're not talking about if you miss church once or once in a while. We all know that things come up. We know how that works. We're really talking about the neglecting of going to church, the neglecting of fellowship together is really, it's the creasters, isn't it? So here's maybe a measurement of that. You miss church once and it's an emergency. You miss church two times in a row and it's a great vacation. You miss church three times in a row and it's a series of unfortunate. And you miss church four times and it's a habit. We're talking about the four churchers and it's a habit. So this month, or about 2 months ago now, I think it's 11 weeks, my wife Donna and I became grandparents for the very first time. And you're going to get to see a little Sophie coming up on the screen there. And our little Sophie girl is 11 weeks old now, and she's part of our family. And she has aunts and uncles and grandma and grandpa and mom and dad, and it's all about, and Sophie just is part of our family. But imagine for a minute that next week when Sophie wakes up in the middle of the night, which is kind of fun for my daughter, is she decides, hey, Mom, just leave the diapers where I can find them, leave the bottles on a lower level so I can reach them, and I'll see you on Christmas and Easter. Yeah, that's not going to happen. That would be our Sophie would never survive. She needs her family. And you know what? When we come to know the Lord as Savior, when we put our trust in what Jesus did for us on the cross, we get a new family, God's family, the church. And imagine if I got saved and I'm on my own. I have Jesus now and off I go. And no, we need each other. If we're going to survive, if we're going to stir each other up, if we're going to hold on, if we're going to draw near, if we're going to do all the things that we've talked about this morning, we need each other to do it. You know, someday Jesus is going to gather his church together. And when we gather on Sunday mornings, it's kind of a rehearsal for the big day.
All right, you're in the sermon now. We're talking about who? This is who? This is us. And so look at your notes and let's review together what we've learned about us. We're going to say these out loud together. First, we learned from Andy. We what? We draw near. We. And finally, this point from the end of verse 25, we encourage. Look at the last part there. It says, but encouraging one another and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Now at Harvest, we believe that every word in the Bible is inspired by God, even the buts. And so why but, not and? Because with the help of that word, God is using that word to highlight the contrast between choosing to neglect coming together and then doing life together. God is telling us through this passage what the church does when it gathers. We encourage. And if you came to church today feeling discouraged, then I have hope for you. God's made a provision for you to be encouraged, and it's in coming together with his people. But what is encouragement? Is it just a bunch of high fives and attaboys? I hope it's more than that. And I'm so happy to tell you that it is. And, as Brandon highlighted, this letter was written in Greek, and the Greek word used here is parakaleo, which actually is four words brought together to make the word encouragement. So those four words are to strengthen, to admonish, to instruct, and to comfort. And so one way to know how you're doing at encouraging someone is to ask yourself, did that person actually receive one of those things that encouragement does? So let's start with strengthen. And to encourage is to strengthen. So perhaps you could ask yourself, did that person come away from their time with me feeling increased in their capacity? The other day, I had a meeting in the evening after a really long day. I was tired. But I was going to spend the night with two of the most encouraging couples that I know. And by the end of the evening, my soul had been strengthened. Had something to do with the food, no doubt. But it was more than that. It was because I had gathered together with my brothers and sisters. So to encourage is to strengthen. It also is to admonish, to instruct. And we do that best when we use God's word. And so as an example, when you meet with John, maybe, to talk about his work ethic, does he know what to do now? Because you took him to a passage like Colossians 3:23 that says to work heartily as unto the Lord. Or when you taught Julie about serving God, did you take her to a scripture like Romans 12 that will teach her about spiritual gifts? To encourage is to strengthen, it's to admonish and instruct, and finally, it's to bring comfort. Are people refreshed because of your care for them? You know, there are a lot of ways that we can care for people. I'm learning that it starts really well by spending time with them, asking good questions, and then listening. But not stopping there, you take what you've learned from your listening and then you pray. But don't just stop there. Pray with them right there. And how about this? Pray God's caring word for them, for the grieving. How about Psalm 34:18, that he is near to the brokenhearted, or to the discouraged, Psalm 86:4, that God gladdens the soul of his servant. Why? Why do we do this? Why should we encourage? Here's why. Make a note of this. Because we do not just attend a service in a building on Sundays. We belong to one another. We belong to one another. Look back in the text where it speaks to this. It says we encourage one another. This is not just the job of the pastors or for the few that have been gifted in this. This is us encouraging one another. And I get that for some of you, this will be reaching out over your skis. It's going to be a stretch. And so let me help you by giving you three questions to consider right now about encouragement. Number one, who? Who in your life is just waiting for you to encourage them? And then how? How are you going to encourage them? We live in a day when we have limitless ways to communicate with people. A text, a post, an email. How about getting together over a cup of coffee? That's some ideas of how, and then, of course, when. How about today or this week? In just a few weeks, the Chicago Marathon's going to take place, and our own Jen Hawkins and Pastor Tommy are going to run in the Chicago Marathon. They are so crazy. I mean, so inspirational. Yeah. And get this. Not only are thousands going to be running that race, but thousands more are going to be lining the streets doing what? Encouraging these runners to finish the race. And just like those runners will be motivated to finish, God, through this text right here, right now, is calling us, his church, to encourage one another so that we would persevere in the race to that day when Jesus Christ returns. That brings us to the last thought in this verse. And all the more, it says, as you see the day drawing near. We're to encourage all the more as you see the day. That's capital D for a reason, because it's the day when Jesus is coming back to get us, to make all things right. And only God knows when that day is, but what we do know is that today we're one closer to that day than we were yesterday. And that's why God's word is saying to us today that we should all the more do the things that we're talking about today. And so as time is moving us closer to that day, these five commitments that we've learned should be increasing in your life. So I want you to think back right now over the last month, the last year. Do you see yourself increasing in nearness to Christ? Are you increasing in holding fast to his promises and stirring up others in your commitment to gather and how you encourage? Are you increasing in these commitments? Because here, this is us. This is who we are, church. And because of who we are, this is what we do. So throughout this service, I know that God, through his Spirit, is doing in you what I know he's doing in us, and he's saying, that's the one. Look back in the notes. Which one is it that he's putting his finger on and saying, my child, this is the one that we're going to work on this year? Circle that. Push it to the front of your mind. And I want to help you, because as you've heard a few times already, one last appeal. You cannot do this on your own. The people that I know that are thriving in their commitments are the ones who are connected. They're connected to a small group. They're connected to serving the Lord. And so after the service, make your way into the lobby so that you can learn more and take that step to growing in Christ. It's important. This is who we are. This is us. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this opportunity to hear from you through your word today. And God, I know that you're here today through your Spirit, and you're pointing out what you want us to see and to know, and then you're going to help us through your presence in our lives to live out what we're learning today, to take action. And for those who need to draw near in community, help them today. Guide them to exactly where it is you want them to be. God, you're good. You've started a good work in us. We know that you're going to finish it because you promised. And we pray all this in your name, Jesus. Amen.